We shall commence this module by discussing about regionalism and multilateralism in brief. Since World War II, the globalization of the world economy has progressed at a tremendous speed. This became possible due to the increment in the economic activities, especially in international trade. The main theme of globalization is the evolution of a unitary political and economic global space. Regionalism is its inherent part and represents regional linking and cooperation, mostly of the countries in proximity. Protectionist measures represent an obstacle to the modern development of economy and trade in the process of globalization and general interdependence of the modern world. Hence, the liberalization process of the flow of goods, capital, services, and people is the only logical path of accelerated development. Seeing the advantages of removing trade barriers, certain countries have constituted regional institutions within which have gradually liberalized their mutual trade. In this way, they additionally developed their economies and became an instance of successful cooperation. At the other instance, nations which preferred closed economies for fear of being exposed to foreign competition have lagged further and further behind, and comparatively speaking have become increasingly impoverished. Regionalism refers to the pacts among nations in a particular geographical region to lessen and eventually eliminate the tariff and non-tariff restrictions to the free flow of goods and services and factors of production between each other. In parlance of international trade policy, regionalism signifies economic unification of two or more nations on the basis of formal agreements. The concerned partners set out conditions which give preferential treatment to each other as compared to the other countries. Besides, it also refers to a disadvantage of the non-members while dealing with the member countries. Further, regionalism does not imperatively signify a union of nations in particular regions such as in Western Europe or in North America, albeit this is usually the case, but also trade pacts among nations on different continents. Multilateralism is a diplomatic term that signifies cooperation among various countries. President Barack Obama has made multilateralism a central element of US foreign policy under his administration. Multilateralism is largely a post-World War II element of US foreign policy. Such cornerstone US policies as the Monroe Doctrine, 1823, and the Roosevelt Corollary to the Monroe Doctrine, 1903, were unilateral. That is, the United States prescribed the policies sans discussing, consenting, or cooperating with other countries. The US declared war against Germany in the year 1917, almost 3 years after the war started in Europe. It coordinated with Great Britain and France simply because they have a common enemy, aside from combating the General Spring Offensive of 1918, it denied to follow the alliance old style of trench fighting, and when the war ended, the US concerted a separate peace with Germany. When President Woodrow Wilson proposed the League of Nations, a truly multilateral organization, to abate another such war, Americans refused to join. It smacked too much of the European alliance systems that had triggered World War I in the first place. The US also kept itself out of the World Court, a mediating organization with no real diplomatic weight. Only World War II pulled the US towards multilateralism. It worked with Great Britain, the Free French, the Soviet Union, China, and others in a real cooperative alliance. At the end of the war, the US became involved in a flurry of multilateral diplomatic, economic, and humanitarian activity. The US joined the war's victors in the creation of the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund 1944, the United Nations, that is UN, in 1945, and the World Health Organization, that is WHO, in 1948. The US and its Western allies also established the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, that is NATO, in 1949. While NATO is still in existence, it's originated as a military alliance to throw back any Soviet incursion into Western Europe. The US followed that up with the Southeast Asia Treaty Organization, which is known as SEATO, and the Organization of American States, that is OAS. Albeit the OAS has major economic, humanitarian, and cultural aspects, both it and SEATO began as organizations through which the US could prevent communism from infiltrating those regions. Albeit multilateralism relates to the world economy. It must eventually get reflected in the behavior of individual countries to the extent to which they behave in a multilateral fashion. For any particular country, the latter should be treated as a positive function of A. The degree to which discrimination is absent, perhaps the proportion of trade partners and receive identical treatment, and B. The extent to which the country's trading regime approximates free trade. After studying this module, you shall be able to get familiar with the concept of regionalism and multilateralism, get to know about the various levels of regional integration, abreast you with the various schemes inaugurated under regional economic integration, comprehend about the various merits and demerits of regionalism and multilateralism. Let us now discuss about regional integration types. Free trade area. In a free trade area, there are no barriers to the trade of goods and services among member countries. In a theoretically ideal free trade area, no discriminatory tariffs, quotas, subsidies, or administrative obstacles are permitted to hamper trade among the members. Each country, however, is free to decide its own trade policies with respect to non-member countries. Thus, the tariffs placed on the product of non-member countries may vary from member to member. Free trade agreements are the most famous form of regional economic integration, accounting for almost 90% of the total regional agreements. Custom union. This is one step ahead along the road to full political and economic integration. A customs union signifies that there will be no trade barriers among member nations and a common external trade policy will be adopted. Establishment of a common external trade policy requires important administrative machinery to oversee trade relations with non-members. Common market. A common market states that there will be no barriers to trade among member nations, a common external trade policy will be adopted, and the factors of production will be allowed to move without any restriction among member nations. Establishing a common market requires a prominent degree of harmony and cooperation in fiscal, monetary, and employment policies. Achieving this degree of cooperation has proven very difficult. Economic union. An economic union provides for even closer economic integration and coordination than a common market. Like the common market, it includes free flow of products and factors of production among member nations and the adoption of a common external policy. Besides, it also demands a common currency harmonization of members' tax rates and a common fiscal and monetary policy. Such a degree of integration requires coordination, bureaucracy, and the sacrifice of a significant amount of national sovereignty to that bureaucracy. Political union. The step in the direction of economic union throws light on how can coordinate bureaucracies be made accountable to the people of member nations. The answer is through political union, in which a central political structure coordinates the social, economic, and foreign policy of the member nations. The EU is on the way towards at least a partial political union. The European Parliament, which is playing an ever more important role in the EU, has been directly elected by the citizens of the EU countries since late 1970s. In addition, the Council of Ministers comprises of government ministers from each EU member. The US provides an instance of even closer political union. In the US, independent states are effectively combined into a single nation. Ultimately, the EU may move towards a similar federal structure. Moving on to discuss some important agreements under regional economics integration. First, the North American Free Trade Agreement, that is NAFTA. The governments of the US and Canada in 1988 agreed to enter into a free trade agreement which took effect on January 1, 1989. The objective of the agreement was to eliminate all tariffs on bilateral trade between Canada and the US by 1998. This was followed in 1991 by talks among the US, Canada and Mexico focused at establishing a NAFTA for three countries. The talks concluded in August 1992 with an agreement in principle, and the following year the agreement was ratified by the government of all the three countries. The agreement became law on January 1, 1994. NAFTA's contents: abolition without 10 years of tariffs on 99% of goods traded between Mexico, Canada and US, removal of various restrictions on the cross-border flow of services allowing financial institutions, example, unhindered access to the Mexican market by 2000, protection of intellectual property rights, removal of almost all barriers on FDI between the three member countries, albeit preferential treatment or protection to be given to the Mexican energy and railway industries, American airline and radio communication industries and the Canadian culture. Application of national environment standards provided such standards have specific bases. Lowering of standard to lure investment is described as being inappropriate. Establishment of two commissions which will have the power to levy fines and eliminate trade privileges when environmental standards or legislations involving health and safety, minimum wages or child labor are ignored. The Canadian, Mexican and the US government began talks in 1995 regarding the Chile's possible entry into NAFTA. As of 2005, however, these talks has yielded little progress, partly because of the political opposition in the US Congress to expanding NAFTA. In December 2002, however, the US and Chile did sign a bilateral free trade pact. Second, European Free Trade Association, that is EFTA, EFTA. Constituted in January 1960, EFTA currently joins four countries: Norway, Liechtenstein, Iceland and Switzerland, down from seven in 1995. EFTA was formed by those Western European countries that initially decided not to be a part of the European community. The focus of EFTA has been on free trade in industrial goods. Agriculture was not included in the arrangement. Each member was allowed to decide its own level of support. Members are also free to decide the level of protection applied to goods coming from outside the EFTA. Third is European Union, that is EU. The European Union is a combination of the two political factors. First, the devastation of Western Europe during two world wars and the appetite for the peace. And second, the European nations' appetite to hold their own on the world's economic and political stage. The forerunner of EU, the European Coal and Steel Community, was constituted in 1951 by Belgium, France, Italy, West Germany, Luxembourg and the Netherlands. Its aim was to eliminate the restrictions to intra-group shipments of coal, iron and steel and scrap metal. The European Community was established with the signing of the Treaty of Rome in 1957. The name got changed again in 1994 when the European Community became the European Union following the ratification of the Maastricht Treaty. In December 1991, European Commission members signed the Maastricht Treaty that devoted them to accepting a common currency by January 1, 1999. The euro is now used by 19 of the 28 member states of the EU. These 19 states are members of the eurozones. A high degree of price stability, a sound fiscal situation, stable exchange rates, converged long-term interest rates. There are certain other important regional integration are also working smoothly. Prominent among them are ASEAN, that is Association of Southeast Asian Nations, CAN, that is Canadian Community, CEFTA, that is Central European Free Trade Agreement, EFTA, European Free Trade Agreement, MERCOSUR, that is Southern Common Market, NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement, SAPTA, South Asian Preferential Trading Arrangement. Moving on to discuss the advantages and disadvantages of regionalism. The case for regionalism. First, the economic argument. Regionalism may be regarded as an attempt to actualize gains from the unrestricted flow of investments and trade between countries beyond those attainable under international agreements such as the WTO. Cooperation and policy harmonization obstacles occur basically because of the large number of nations that desire agreement. If the number of nations involved is large, the more perspectives will be there that must be reconciled and the harder it will be to reach the agreement. Thus, attempts at regionalism are motivated by a desire to exploit the gains from unrestricted trade and investment. Second, the political argument. The political case for integration has also loomed large in most attempts to establish free trade areas, customs union and the like. Political cooperation can be enhanced and the chances of violent conflict can be reduced by linking the neighboring countries or economies with each other. In addition, by combining their economies, the nations can invigorate their political weights in the world. The case against regionalism. Although regionalism aids the majority, it has its cost. Although the country as a whole may be at large significantly from a regional free trade agreement, certain groups may lose. Moving to a free trade regime involves painful adjustments. The integration arises from concerns over national sovereignty. These concerns arise since for the objective of the close economic integrations, the nations are required to give up some amount of control over key issues like fiscal policy, monetary policy and trade policy. Although the motion has been strong in favor of regional free trade pacts in recent years, some economists have expressed concern that the merits of the regional integration have been oversold while the demerits have been ignored. They mention that the advantages of regional integration are the product of the extent of trade creation as opposed to the trade diversion. Trade creation signifies that the low-cost producers within the free trade area are replacing the high-cost domestic producers. It may also occur when high-cost external producers are replaced by lower-cost external producers within free trade area. Trade diversion occurs high-cost suppliers within the free trade area replacing the low-cost external suppliers. The benefits from the regional free trade agreement will accrue only if the amount of trade created is more than the amount of trade diverted. In theory, the aim of the WTO rules should be to assure that free trade agreement does not lead to trade diversion. These rules permit free trade areas to be constituted only if the members set tariffs lower or less restrictive to outsiders than the one currently in practice. However, GATT and WTO do not cover some non-tariff barriers. As a result, regional trade blocs could enlarge whose markets are protected from outside competition by high non-tariff barriers. In such cases, the trade diversion effects might outweigh the trade creation effects. Next, we will discuss the advantages and disadvantages of multilateralism. The case for multilateralism. First, cost and efficiency. One advantage of multilateralism is that different countries possess different kinds of resources and areas of expertise. Nations working together can pool these resources and experience more successful results as well as cost savings. In economic and environmental areas, many nations working in tandem can achieve better outcomes than each country acting in isolation. One instance of this is the Kyoto Protocol, in which various nations affirmed to simultaneously lessen their levels of greenhouse gas emissions. Second, diplomatic respect. Another advantage of multilateralism, and possibly the most prominent one, is that it provides goodwill and respect from other countries. When a country acts in isolation, sans considering the impact on trade, investment and the economy of other countries, it may engender a chill in diplomatic relations and usually ravage a nation's international reputation. This can make it more difficult for that country to work with other nations in the future on other matters. The case against multilateralism. First, different priorities. One major demerit of multilateralism is that it slows down the decision-making process and sometimes it significantly hampers the decision making. It may also signify that a government does not get everything that it wants or does not get what it wants in the given time frame. Different countries and governments will have different priorities and different ideas about what actions should be taken, in what order, and with what type of objectives in mind. The time frame as well as the objectives of a proposed action may be compromised in order to act multilaterally. Second, organizational issues. Another disadvantage of multilateralism is in carrying out operations with other countries. While resource sharing can prove advantageous to countries, it can make matters more complicated. Many countries have strict rules in place for their armed forces, relief agencies, and other workers. Different countries have different methods of getting things done and varying chains of command, and some countries do not like their personnel to be under the command of another country. While making decisions and executing the things, it may engender confusion and miscommunication. Let us now summarize what we have discussed in this module. In international economics, most debated point is whether these regional groups support or hamper the WTO's multilateral trading system or not. A committee is closely watching increasing regional agreements in international trade. They appear contradictory. One viewpoint is that regional trade agreements can literally auspice the WTO's multilateral trading system. Normally, creating a custom union or free trade area contravenes the WTO's principle of equal treatment for all trading partners, but GATT's Article 24 allows regional trading arrangements to be set up as a special exception provided specific strict criteria are met. Article 24 states that the trade and other barriers should be reduced significantly in order to create a custom union or a free trade area. Non-member should find trade with the group more liberal than before the creation of the group. Similarly, Article 5 of the General Agreement on Trade in Services provides for economic integration agreements in services. Other provisions in the WTO agreements permit developing countries to enter into regional or global pacts that encompass the elimination or reduction of tariffs and non-tariff barriers on trade among themselves. On 6th February 1996, the WTO General Council created the Regional Trade Agreement Committee. Its goal is to investigate regional groups and assess whether they violate the WTO rules or not. The committee is also examining how regional arrangements might affect the multilateral trading system and what the relationship between regional and multilateral arrangements might be.